78. At Bic Yu he pities the infants and summons the night gods. In the Golden Hall he knows the demon speaking on the way and virtue. One thought will stir up a demonic crew. So bitter's training, though what can you do? Rely on washing to remove the dust. The body harness and refine you must. Sweep clean all causations to stillness return. Stamp out every fiend without concern. Of shackle and snare you'll surely leap free. And rise, when work is done, to great canopy. We were telling you about the great sage Sun, who, having exerted every effort, succeeded in eliciting the assistance of Tathagata to subdue the fiends. When the ordeal finally ended, Tripitaka and his disciples left the Lion Camel Kingdom and journeyed westward. After several months, it was again the time of winter. You see the peaks jade-like plums half-blooming. The pond's water slowly icing. The red leaves have all dropped away. And pines turn more verdant and gay. The pale clouds are about to snow. Dried grass on the mountain lies low. What frigid scene now fills the eyes? As bone-piercing chill multiplies. Braving the cold and plunging through the chill, resting in the rain and feeding on the wind, master and disciples proceeded until they saw another city. Wukong? Asked Tripitaka. What sort of a place is that over there? When you get there? Replied Pilgrim. You'll know. If it's a kingdom of the West, we'll have to have our rescript certified. If it's merely a district, county, or prefecture seat, we'll just pass through. Hardly had master and disciples finished speaking than they arrived at the foot of the city gate. Tripitaka dismounted, and the four of them entered the outer wall of the city, where almost immediately they found an old soldier huddled against the wind and sleeping beneath a wall exposed to sunlight. Pilgrim walked up to him and shook him gently, saying, "Officer." Waking with a start and blinking several times, the old soldier finally caught sight of Pilgrim. Immediately he went to his knees and kowtowed, crying, "Holy Father! Stop making all this fuss!" said Pilgrim. "I'm no evil spirit. Why should you address me as Holy Father? Aren't you Holy Father Thunder God?" asked the old soldier, still kowtowing. "Certainly not," said Pilgrim. "I am a priest from the land of the East on his way to seek scriptures in the Western Heaven. I just arrived, and I came to ask you for the name of your region." Only when he heard those words did the old soldier calm down. With a big yawn he scrambled up to stretch himself and say, "Elder, Elder, pardon me. This place was originally the Bic Yu Kingdom, but now the name has been changed to the Young Master's City." "Is there a king in the city?" asked Pilgrim. "Yes. Yes. Yes," replied the old soldier. Pilgrim turned back to say to the Tang monk, "Master, this place originally was called the Bic Yu Kingdom, but it has been changed now to the Young Master's City. I don't know why they changed the name. If it was Bic Yu," said a perplexed Tang monk, "why then should it be called Young Masters?" "Eight rules said. It must be that the Bic Yu king had died. The one newly occupying the throne is a young master, and that's why it's called the Young Master's City." "Nonsense. Nonsense," said the Tang monk. "Let's go inside the city first. We may make further inquiry on the streets."
"Exactly,"
said Sha monk. "That old soldier is probably ignorant, or he may have been frightened into babbling by Big Brother. Let's go into the city to make inquiry." They walked through three levels of city gates before they reached the big thoroughfares. As they paused to look around, they found that the people here all seemed to be good-looking and handsomely dressed. What they came upon were wine shops and some bars full of raucous din. Tall colors adorned a tea house or inn. Business was good at every gate and door. Abundant wealth packed both mart and store. People, like ants, traded brocade and gold. For fame and for profit they bought and sold. What solemn manners! Such prosperous scene! Of calm seas and rivers, a year serene. Toting the luggage and leading the horse, Master and disciples walked for a long time on the main boulevards, where the sight of prosperity seemed endless. Then they began to notice that in front of each household was a geese coop. "Oh, disciples," said Tripitaka, "all the people here put a geese coop in front of their house. Why is that?" On hearing this, Eight Rules looked left and right, and he saw that indeed there were these geese coops lined with silk curtains of five colors. "Master," said our idiot with a giggle, "this must be an auspicious day for marriage or for meeting friends. The people must all be performing some rituals."
"Rubbish," snapped Pilgrim. "How could every household be performing a ritual? There must be a reason for this.
Let me go and take a look."
"You'd better not go," said Tripitaka, tugging at him.
"Your hideous features will offend people."
"I'll go in transformation then," replied Pilgrim.
"Dear great sage." Making the magic sign, he recited a spell and changed with one shake of his body into a little bee. Wings outstretched, he flew up to one of the coops and crawled inside the curtains. There he discovered a little child sitting in the middle. When he went to another coop, he found another child also. In fact, he discovered the same thing in front of eight or nine households. They were all little boys, and there were no girls at all. Some of them were playing in the coops. Others merely sat and cried. Still others were eating fruit or sleeping. After seeing that, Pilgrim changed back into his original form to report to the Tang monk. "There are little boys in the coops. The older ones cannot be more than 7 years old, and some of the younger ones are barely five. I don't know why they are in there." His words made Tripitaka more perplexed than ever. A turn on the street brought them all at once up to the gate of an official mansion, the Golden Pavilion Postal Station.
"Disciples," said Tripitaka, highly pleased, "let's go inside this postal station. We can ask them about the place, feed our horse, and request lodging for the night."
"Exactly. Exactly," said Sha Monk. "Let's get inside quickly." As the four of them entered amiably, the officers on duty at once announced their arrival to the station master, who ushered them inside. After they had exchanged greetings and taken their seats, the station master asked,
"Elder, where did you come from?"
"Your humble cleric," replied Tripitaka, "has been sent by the great Tang in the land of the east to go seek scriptures in the western heaven. Having arrived in your noble region, we would like to have our travel rescript certified and to beg you to grant us one night's lodging in your lofty mansion." The station master immediately requested tea and asked those on duty to prepare the tokens of hospitality. Having thanked him, Tripitaka asked again, "Is it possible for me to enter the court today and have an audience with the throne and get my rescript certified?"
"You can't do it tonight," said the station master.
"Wait until early court tomorrow. Please spend the night and rest here in our humble dwelling." In a little while, when the preparation had been finished, the station master invited the four pilgrims to partake of a vegetarian meal. His subordinates were ordered to sweep clean the guest room for the pilgrims to rest. After thanking him repeatedly, Tripitaka sat down and said to the station master, "There is something that this humble cleric must ask you to explain. How do the people of your noble region rear young children?"
The station master said,
"As there are number two sons in heaven, so there are number two rational principles on earth. The rearing of children begins with the sperm of the father and the blood of the mother. After the 10th month of conception, the child will be born in due time. And after birth, the child will be fed with milk for at least 3 years, until the bodily features are fully formed. You think we do not know about this? According to what you have just told me," replied Tripitaka, "the people here are no different from those of my humble nation. But when I entered the city just now, I saw that there was placed in front of each household a geese coop, inside of which was placed a little boy. I don't understand this, and that's why I dare request an explanation."
"Elder, don't mind that," said the station master, at once lowering his voice and whispering into Tripitaka's ear. "Don't ask about that, and don't be concerned with that.
Don't speak of it, even. Please rest now, and you can be on your way tomorrow. On hearing this, however, the elder tugged at the station master and persisted in his request for an explanation. As he shook his head and wagged his finger, all the station master could mutter was, "Be careful with what you say." Refusing to let go, Tripitaka insisted that he be told the reason. The station master had little choice but to send away all his official attendants, after which he said quietly, alone, by the light of the lamps, "The matter of the geese coops that you mentioned just now happens to be instigated by the unruliness of our lord. Why do you persist in asking about it?" "What do you mean by unruliness?" asked Tripitaka. "You must help me understand before I can rest. This country," said the station master, "used to be called the Bikyu Kingdom, but recent folk songs have changed the name to the Young Master's City. 3 years ago, an old man, disguised as a Taoist, arrived with a young girl, barely 16, and with a face as beautiful as Guanyin's. He presented her as a tribute to Our Majesty, who became so infatuated with her that he gave her the title of Queen Beauty. In recent times, he would not even look at any of the royal consorts dwelling in the 6 chambers and 3 palaces. Night and day he cares only to indulge in amorous dalliance with this one girl until he is reduced to a physical wreck. Constantly fatigued, emaciated, and unable to eat or drink, he has not long to live.